being asked to play possibly the most famous woman of the last 50 years, where on earth do you begin?
Oh, I don't really know, to be honest. I think, obviously, with the script, and then you sort of, I've said this many times, but sort of have to forget everything that you know, or everything that your all preconceived ideas that you had, because I don't think you can approach it as kind of someone who's grown up with that family, because we all have, and it's a very odd thing to then try and approach them as human beings, because you sort of want to hold them on a pedestal and you want to see them as these perfect sort of creatures, and you can't do that when you're playing a character. You have to get in there. So that's what we all did, I think, was forget a lot of stuff and then start at the bottom and kind of work your way up, I think. Get the voice right, get the movement right, and then try and kind of get into the way people think.
And did you study archive for things like The Voice? Did you listen to a lot of tapes?
Hours
on YouTube?
Yeah, I think you have to. I mean, I don't know whether it's fortunate or not, but at that time, you know, there wasn't everything that was portrayed of them, it was very much kind of what the palace was putting out there. So any of the broadcasts that they were doing were very engineered and they've been practiced and all those sorts of things. So it's important to get those right, but then you have to in some way bleed that into their personal life in a way that's not contrived or kind of performed, because they weren't performing then. That's the point of the story. So we had to sort of, you know, imagine, I suppose.
And for you, Matt, getting under the skin, as it were, of Prince Philip,
yes.
Is there a lot of information out there, or was a lot of what you were doing conjecture in conjunction with Peter?
Well, all of it comes from the scripts, obviously, but his early life is actually really, really fascinating. And the more research that we did on these people, I think the richer our jobs became in sort of many ways. And there's a wonderful team who gather all this information and all this kind of footage for you, and we just spent as much time as we could and sort of immerse ourselves in the culture of the time and the context politically and the sort of emotional journey of the family, really. But it was really fascinating. I think the preconception that we have about him is actually a misconception. And I think all the things that we think we know about the older version of Philip aren't necessarily true about where he's come from and who he is. So what was fascinating about the series for me, and indeed the research that went into the series, was... yeah, I was enlightened by him, and actually I found him to be the antithesis of what everyone thinks he is, and it was really refreshing, and I think he's a bit of a rock star. I love him.
How did it feel when you finally got to wear the crown?
Amazing. I'd worn it several times in different scenes before that point, unfortunately. It's sort of a question for Dad as well, in a way. Because we wore the same one.
It didn't fit.
It didn't fit me either. We had the same one, so, yeah. In that moment when me and Ronnie were doing the scene together, and it felt very at one with God, not me, but I suddenly went, oh, I see.
You're talking about the coronation in
episode 5.
Yeah,
yeah, yeah, and
yes.
That's when the crown goes on, is after that moment, and she's changed at that point, and from that point on, she is no longer just a woman. She is sort of, I hate to say it, God's chosen person on earth. That's what she thinks, anyway. So it changes her. But for me, it wasn't like I suddenly realised that was my... I should be wearing a crown in real life or anything like that.
Did you take it home? Is it best selfie ever?
Yeah. You would have done.
Did you ever find, when you were on set, did you ever find the cast or the crew reacting to you differently when you were in costume or out of costume?
Mostly, no. No.
Really?
Well, now they do. Now they do that sort of thing.
It's only a matter of time.
And they separate. It's like the sparks go, ma'am.
Do they?
Yeah.
As a joke, I
think people have been curtsying to Helen Mirren for years now. Yeah. And,
I think the series two should make sure they bend the knee.
Yeah.
Matt, tell me a little bit about some of the places you filmed.
Oh, gosh. Well,
where was Malta?
Pardon?
Where was Malta, for example?
South Africa.
Okay.
Which was glorious. And we went down to Cape Town. And then we went also to... I can never pronounance it. Because I'm an idiot.
Natal.
What one?
KwaZulu-Natal.
KwaZulu-Natal.
Yeah.
And we built treetops, actually for real, which is where they went on their honeymoon.
Without their hands.
And it's still up. It's still up. And then we found wonderful on-site locations, so it sort of has the texture and the feel of somewhere that feels very authentic and real. So we'd go to these huge, kind of very cold, stately homes. But I think it's like another character in the show. Really, it really is. And also, London really feels like a character, which is important. It really feels like we've captured London.
Where did you shoot around here? Where was the majority of? I assume Buckingham Palace is not available for hire.
So. No, it's not, sadly. Although the Mall was, so they closed the whole Mall, and I won't actually give it away. But I get to drive up it, and there was no one on it. Just me. It was a very rare, special thing. And Lancaster House was a big one, wasn't it? Where else did we go?
Did you do anything in costume that we wouldn't expect to see the Queen and Philip doing, like, I don't know, have a Domino's or sit and watch the Bake Off final?
Well, it was nice.
Both of those things.
Yeah. I mean, it was the 40s and the 50s, so there was no Bake Off. But
but you in costume.
But, oh, what, as in... As Matt and Claire?
Yeah, but in costume, in between
Christ,
tape.
Yeah, all sorts, because you just have all this downtime on set. So, you know, our only salvage is being ridiculous, isn't it?
Pretty much, yeah. It's and we've spent quite a lot of time, this sounds really awful, but taking them off in South Africa, because it was so hot. So the gloves and the tights and the things and the regimental, and
we really stripped down at one point, didn't we? Because it was like 40 degrees on the tarmac. It was terribly, terribly warm.
It was. They didn't have that luxury.
Entebbe Airport, yeah. But I'm afraid there's nothing more salacious than that, really.
No, we played Bananagram sometimes.
Yes, we did. And I'm terrible at it.
Crown on.
Definitely not crown on. Props would not have allowed me to go anywhere within a sort of 2-centimetre radius with that crown on. I can't be trusted.
And I certainly can't be trusted.
No, definitely not, no.
Do you think that she might watch The Crown? And if so, what would you hope her reaction would be?
Do we know that she did? Did she say that she did?
I think Helen Mirren said that she's aware that she had seen it.
Well, see, I mean, that's the thing about Her Majesty, is that I don't know, unless it comes out of her mouth, I don't believe anything.
Telepathic.
Yeah, hang on. yeah, I can't remember whether she's going to watch it. I mean, I love to imagine that she would. I love nothing more than imagining her sitting down and watching it, because I think that would just be extraordinary.
We then have Netflix and Buckingham Palace.
Yeah, which is a story in itself. But it's a very odd thing for me to think that she would, because I'd be terrified and also really intrigued if someone was playing me in the story of my life. But that's me. I'm not her, and we're very, very different people. But I don't know. I mean, I don't know.
I think she'll be bowled over. Really, yeah. It's a brilliant performance. So why not?